Let us be attentive to the voice of God. God above, source of boundless love.
Spring winds, summer rain, then the heart's spring.
Pearly rice and corn, fragrant autumn morn.
Though our work is hard, God give us some reward.
God's care, like a cloak, wraps us country folk.
Makes all green things grow, ripens what we sow.
Through God we are strong, sing our harvest song.
Sing praise, field and flower, praise God's almighty power.
Thank you.
holy presence, breathe your peace with gifts of warmth and healing light. Support us as we learn new ways to care for bodies newly frail. Help us to
Thank you. 8 of them in class. 16.
Come over here. And have a seat right here. Come on. Make room where you can sit down here on the floor. That's fine too. I want to read you a verse from the Bible. Keep coming. Oh, a little more room. You don't want to hear this? Okay, here's the verse from the Bible. Okay, it's from the book of Psalms, which was the prayer book. This is what they used to worship. They didn't have bulletins back then. And it says, praise God with clanging cymbals, praise Him with loud clashing cymbals, let everything that breathes praise the Lord. Yesterday, I snuck into the church and did something I've never done before.
That's illegal. Whatever you did was illegal.
I sat down here and I did this. And then I did this. So, if God commanded us to praise Him with cymbals, who would like to sit here and do that? Put your foot right there. Now hit the foot right there. Down here. Right there. Step on there. Okay. Again. Right there. Okay. Go ahead. Say, who's next for the stepping over here? Go ahead. Step over here for me. Okay. Step right there. Okay. Next one. Okay. Okay. Liam, you want to hand it to somebody else? Okay. Get that one. Just see how lightly you can do it too. Okay. Thank you. All right. Yeah.
Dear Lord, we never know from day to day what it's going to bring. There's moments of quiet and moments of noise. In the quiet and noise going on internally in us, please quiet those voices so we can listen to your word this morning in the name of speak to our hearts. Amen. Our Old Testament reading is from the book of Job. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind. Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who has determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who is it that stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together, and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
From the 104th Psalm. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, you are very great. You are clothed with honor and majesty, wrapped in light as with a garment. You stretched out the heavens like a tent. You set the beams of your chambers on the waters. You make the clouds your chariot. You ride on wings of the wind. You make the winds your messengers, fire and flame your ministers. You set the earth on its foundations, so that it shall never be shaken. You cover it with the deep as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. At your rebuke they flee, at the sound of your thunder they take flight. They rose up to the mountains, ran down to the valleys, to the place that you appointed for them. You set a boundary that they may not pass, so that they might not cover the earth again. O Lord, how manifold are your works! In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Came up to him. Teacher, we have something we want you to do for us. What is it? He asked them. I'll see what I can do. Arrange it, they said, so that we will be awarded the highest places of honor in your glory, one of us at your right hand and the other at your left. Jesus said, you have no idea what you're asking. Are you capable of drinking the cup I drink, of being baptized in the baptism I'm about to be plunged into? Sure, they said, why not? And Jesus said, come to think of it, you will drink the cup I drink, and you will be baptized into my baptism. But as to awarding places of honor, that's not my business. There are other arrangements for that later. Now, when the other 10 disciples heard about this conversation, they lost their tempers with James and John. Jesus got them together to settle things down. You have already observed how godless rulers throw their weight around, he said. And when people get a little power, how quickly it goes to their heads. It's not going to be that way with you. Whoever wants to be great must be a servant. Whoever wants to be first among you must become a slave. That is what the Son of Man has done. He came to serve, not to be served, and then to give away his life in exchange for many who are held hostage. The Gospel of the Lord in the Message translation.
Thanks be to you, Lord Christ.
Let us pray. Loving God, wake us up to our meaningless prayers, our quest for power and glory, and your commandment to be servants of one another. In Jesus' name. Job was anything but patient, even though we always refer to him as the patience of Job. He screams his protests at God, and he curses the day he was born. How would you manage suffering that you see in others enduring when it was turned around and mangled you? What about the horror of a damaged child, a cancered loved one, or the death of a soldier's son, or suicided friend, or a bloody accident on earth? Could you still have the nonetheless of faith and say you bless God? Could you? We start again with Job in the midst of his suffering. Will Job call upon the name of the Lord who is worthy to be praised? Could Job sing, God is my strong salvation, as we heard in the organ prelude from Psalm 27? Is the Lord the stronghold of your life? Are you afraid? What do you and I do in times of darkness and uncertainty? What do we do for one another when a plant gets ready to close and 225 people lose their jobs? Job thought he was a man of great character and great class and had earned his position. And he was very good at thanking God in his prayers when everything went well. Then Job sat in his ash heap, questioning God. The ash heap was a place where one would sit and toss the ashes over their head to show everyone else how sorry they were. Job was in a sorry mess, but he was only sorry for himself. And then that sorriness turned to anger against God. Picture your worst time of suffering. That's your ash heap and mine. And that's the view that we have of God. Always. Always from the ashes is when God is seen. And every saint and every martyr knew that. And so Job suffers to see God. And Job sees God because he suffers. Even his friends let him down concerning themselves. They began as they visited him with all of these principles that mattered to them rather than caring for the sufferer. They were much more like prosecutors than they were friends, with their rational arguments, until finally Job was left alone in his pain, and no one offered to feel his pain with him. So Job's friend asks him in chapter 11, can you find out the deep things of God? Can you find out the limit of the Almighty? And Jesus gives us the answer. We heard it in the psalm. We hear it each Advent. Emmanuel, God is with us. As familiar as our way home, and yet also at the same time, the God who is as close to us as our breathing in and breathing out, and yet as distant from us as the farthest star. God is both ever close and ever distant, and so we pray for patience from God, and we do call upon the Lord. Another of Job's friends a little later in the book says, God had spoken again and again. God had spoken in dreams and visions. God spoke through pain and suffering of body and spirit. God has spoken through messengers and angels and others who acted as mediators for God. But you see, Job already knew about that. That wasn't connecting with his suffering. That was just preaching to the choir. This friend accused Job of not listening to God, which was not true. Job was a good listener. Pay heed, he said to Job, listen to me, be silent, and I will teach you wisdom. We might not have used those words, but how often has it sounded that way to our friends? No, in this case, don't listen to this friend. And for that matter, none of his friends, the three who came one after another, and then finally the one who seemed wiser, who wasn't. Our best friends are the ones who do not point us to them, but point us to God. 2 weeks ago, we started this talk about Job with Job's integrity, how his mind, body, and spirit needed to come together in a balance. He claimed he was innocent of any suffering, but only because he was still believing that he was not guilty and had no reason to suffer. Last week, we heard the story about Douglas, hurt in a DWI accident, who discovered that God also was angry and that God grieved with him in his pain. We heard the story of Victoria, the reformed woman of the streets who started a ministry called Victoria's Friends to help others in strip clubs. God loves us unconditionally and calls us to do the same with others. We never know when God is going to put someone beside us at a church service, out getting coffee at Tim Hortons, at Walmart in line, or at 40,000 feet, as happened to Penny Duckworth. She met a woman there in the plane. As you engage in those conversations, nobody's going out for a walk, so you're kind of stuck with the person next to you. And the woman started talking about her daughter in Israel. Penny assumed this woman was Jewish. She was a Christian. She had raised her daughter to be Jewish. And seeing Penny's puzzled look, she said, "Let me explain. When the Nazis came to her village in Poland to round up the Jews for transport to the camps, no one really knew what was going on, but everyone sensed something dreadful was happening in their little town. The smell of death was in the air. This woman was doing her weekly shopping near the train station the day the Nazis arrived. Gestapo officers were pushing the Jewish villagers onto the trains, and one was pushing a woman who had a little girl next to her. The soldier turned to the Jewish woman, pointed to her daughter, and asked roughly, 'Is this your child?' And then the woman stopped and looked straight at this other woman and said, 'No, this child is hers.' 'And so you took her daughter?' Penny asked. 'Yes,' she nodded. 'What would you have done?' Jesus called his followers to be salt and light to the earth and to the hurting world and the dark world, and to show his qualities of compassion to others. Therefore, whenever we act out of kindness, we respond to Jesus' own call to discipleship, to serve others. All of us at times have felt excluded from the human family. At these moments when we most need our friends, it seems that no one is reaching out, no one is listening, no one even looks. Now, there are two large groups of people in our world: those who live only for themselves, and those who are open to the transformative work of God in their lives and in the lives of others. Jesus knew that people, unlike salt, could lose their savor and their saltiness, and that if they did, they would be useless. 12th century mystic wrote that humanity was given three sets of eyes, each building on the previous one. And see where your eyes are and which one you emphasize more. The first set of eyes are our senses and what we feel and what we perceive and see and touch and smell. We see also with our minds of reason, and we do that after we take in the input from our senses. And after using our senses and our minds, we then have the opportunity to see situations with another set of eyes. That's what's deep within our heart. It's called contemplation. In our prayer groups, we call them God moments, a good term. So God asks us, will you listen, like Penny on the plane, for when God speaks? God speaks, and we need to listen. It can come through other people. It can come through circumstances. It can come in very surprising ways that makes us wonder, is that really God speaking? Listen when God speaks through other people. And that's why, as the children learned a couple of weeks ago, that we need to see the face of Jesus in each other. One of the masks I did is out there on the table in the assembly room. Because if we see the face of Jesus in others, we're much more likely to listen than if we see the face of someone we know. So listen when God speaks through others. Marcello in a Real World is a book about a 17-year-old boy. He's looking forward to his senior year of high school. He's diagnosed with a syndrome with special needs. And so Marcello has spent all of his time growing up learning how to do things other people learn intuitively. We look at somebody's expression on their face and we can judge whether or not they're happy or sad. Marcello had trouble determining that. What does that particular expression on someone's face mean? How is a person feeling when their face doesn't show it? But Marcello is good with animals. He hears music playing in his head. And he's always feeling comfortable if there's a predictable schedule and routine for his life. And Marcello has a special interest in God. Marcello pursues his interest by praying, studying holy books, going to Mass, and regularly meeting with a rabbi friend. But his father is concerned that all of this nonsense is not really preparing him for the real world. So his father puts Marcello to work in the mailroom of his business. If you follow the rules, then you will be old enough to make a decision, and you can choose where you spend your senior year of high school. So Marcello goes to work in the mailroom. He finds an envelope one day and sees in it a picture of a girl's face badly disfigured from an accident caused by his father's firm. He has to decide what to do with that evidence. He's deeply troubled by the girl's apparent suffering, but he is worried he is overreacting, since his father has told him don't overreact to other people. No rule book can tell him what to do. He wants to go to the girl's defense, but he doesn't know how, and so he goes back to the rabbi and he asks for help. Listen carefully, the rabbi says, and God will give you the next note of music. But how do I know that the next note is the right one? He asks her. She says, the right note sounds right, and the wrong note sounds wrong. So, how does someone discern God's will in the midst of suffering? The rabbi continues, what else can we do but trust God as the source of what we feel and hope? Whatever the feeling might be, whatever the hope might be pointing towards. That is faith, she tells him, following the music when we don't hear it. I talked with Job, and I asked how he learned to talk with God. See, other people evaluate us according to how we perform, or how we look to them, or how we meet their expectations. But God cares for each one of us simply because we belong to God, so we can face life without fear. If God has given you silence, then praise God. Silence is God's sign of bringing you into a whole new understanding of who God is. God speaks to you in your suffering, and God speaks to you in the silence. Listen. Listen. Let us pray. Take away our voice. Take away our hearing. Take away our touch and our smell. Take away our expectations. Take away our minds and leave us only in the depths of our heart and there on the ash pits of our sufferings. Let us see you and listen for the next note of music. In the silence you give us.
He is supreme in the end. pieces of the universe,
people
and
things,
animals
and atoms,
get properly fixed
and
fit together
in
vibrant harmonies, all because of his death,
his
blood that poured down from the cross.
Join in prayer. silence that we are afraid of, the silence that we desire, the silence that you give us as a gift. We are grateful for the noise of Psalm 150 and for the joyful exuberance of our children. And we are still grateful for the silence. We thank you that we are able to reach out to one another, learning how not to do it as Job's friends did, but to do as you have commanded, to be the least of all, to be the servants one of another, to see the face of your Son in the face of every stranger. We thank you that when we do that, others too may glimpse your face in ours as well. We thank you for the joys of these fall seasons and the changes, for the frost on the grass and the reminder that seasons come and go. But your love for us is always constant and sure. Your love does not evaporate with the mist of the morning. Your love does not change in the coldness of the night. Your love is not dependent upon geothermals and heaters and furnaces. Your love towards us is always warm, kindled at times by the fire of your anger, kindled at times by the grief of your tears and your disappointment with us, but constant and sure nonetheless, for you are worthy to be praised, worthy in all times, in all circumstances, in all situations. So we lift up to you those who are distant from us, those who are going through troubling times with addictions, those who have not yet heard the good news from someone to whom they can listen, someone who connects with them at their own level, someone who shares their own heartbreak, someone who is willing to join them in the ash pit. We thank you for the ashes of forgiveness, the ashes of the past that is now past. We thank you that you call us to dream dreams and see visions. So we see it in the eyes of our children. We see it holding a newborn close to us. We see it in the morning sunrise. And we see it in each other because we come here as hopeful people, connected to one another and not alone, at least for this hour, as distant as a pew away and yet as close as sharing your praises. So we give you thanks day after day, day in and day out. In the heights and in the depths, nothing can separate us from our praise of you, for which we always give you thanks. In Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Included in our announcements today, starting today, parents are asked to fill out a brief information form about their child and will receive a pager similar to that in a restaurant, but there is no food at the end of the pager in case they are needed during the service. So if you or if you invite friends to come, check with Aaron, but Judy Meiser down at Nursery Care will let you know about those. Flowers are given in loving memory of parents and grandparents by Donna Westfall. Thank you, Donna. And annual picnic and hayride, 4:30 next Sunday. So invite some friends. And now an announcement from Chuck.
Our worship next week will be centered around a hymn festival that will be led by four of our choirs and the Roscoe Brass Quintet and Matt Hayes. And we'll be singing some of your favorites. Well, For a Thousand Tons to Sing and The Tie of the Cross, and I Love to Tell the Story. And it's a great time to invite someone to join you. It's a non-threatening way. So think about who you might like to come and be a part of our fellowship. Thank you.
God is known as the gift giver. God gives us love to share with one another. God gives us talents to help others. Look to God as the source of all of life and love. Our life together is a lifelong journey as we respond to God's calling to each of us. So I've asked Chuck to stand here today.
Yeah.
We just found out. And we would like today to recognize Chuck Snyder's 50 years of receiving God's gift of music and sharing it with others. While Chuck has served God in this church for 38 years, he began his musical gift giving to the world back in 1965. We celebrate God's goodness to us, and we affirm God's continuing presence in Chuck's life through this gift of music, a gift of music that echoes in his mind, reverberates in his heart, and comes forth through his voice and the tips of his fingers. God is calling through the whisper of the Spirit, Spirit's deepest sighs, through the... God is calling through the whisper of the Spirit's deepest sighs, through the thrill of sudden beauties that can catch us by surprise. Flash of wonder, hush of stillness, rush of wonder. God is calling. Can you hear? God is calling. Can you hear? God is calling through the music of sublime and human arts, through the hymns of earth and angels and the carols of our hearts. Lift of joy and gift of singing, days and nights our praises bringing. God is calling and we hear. God is calling and we hear. Do you, the members and friends of the Presbyterian Church, give thanks to Almighty God for the breadth, the depth, and joy and harmony of Chuck's gifts of music? If so, respond with, we do. Let us pray. Loving God, whose gifts know no ending, thank you for the grace notes of Chuck's music flowing out through the lives of so many. We thank you for his parents, grandparents, his teachers, his mentors, his friends, his encouragers, and his students. May this church continue to be blessed by his composing, his conducting, his leading, and most of all, by his discipleship to you as Lord. To God alone be the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
On behalf of the worship committee, where Chuck has met monthly to report on music programs of our church and what now includes 8 choirs and 2 organists, we invite the congregation, all of you, to share their gratitude to God for greeting Chuck at the coffee hour after worship in the assembly room. Thanks be to God.
Gives us so much to share with others. Let us receive our morning offering.
Thank you.
from heaven above, with wisdom, power, and love.